Hi everyone. Hi, I'm Dr. Shritama. Today I'm going to talk about a very important topic of class 10th biology. That is, I'm going to talk about the chapter life processes. So when we tell about life processes, what is it that we actually mean? For continuing of life, or for carrying out our life, or for any living being, some processes are very important. Or for a living being to be alive, some things are very important, are very necessary, without which you cannot have or cannot live a life. So the processes or the functions which are very important for living is will be discussed under this chapter, life processes. So the first thing that we are going to talk about is nutrition. So when we tell about nutrition, what is nutrition? Nutrition is the process by which organisms receive and utilize their food taken in the form of their growth, survival, and also the repair of their worn out cells. So when we tell about nutrition, it is the process by which organisms utilize the food taken, in the form of their growth, survival, and repair of worn out cells. So nutrition, when you are talking of nutrition, or when we are talking of nutrition, the thing that we have to be very careful about, or when we are writing the definition of nutrition, the thing that we have to be very careful about, we have to tell that organisms receive and utilize the food taken. They receive the food and they utilize that food. The organisms have to receive, every living being have to take in some food. That is, they receive the food and they utilize the food taken. How they utilize the food? That is in the form of their growth, for their survival, and for the repair of their worn out cells. And such a process is called nutrition. That process we know as called nutrition. So this will be the first life processes that we are going to discuss about, or we are going to talk about. I'll tell you more about the process of nutrition in detail. We're going to discuss about life processes in four different parts, that is nutrition, respiration, transportation, and excretion. The first that we'll start with is nutrition. So what we have just learned about, that life processes includes four important processes without which life cannot sustain. So now we are going to talk about nutrition. So what is nutrition? It is the process by which an organism takes food, it takes the food and it utilizes it for its growth, development and various synthesizing and repair activities. So the process by which an organism takes food and utilizes it for its growth, this is one important point, development, two, various synthesizing and repair activities. So initially when we talk about nutrition, nutrition can be immediately divided into two types of nutrition, that is autotrophs and heterotrophs. And the method of nutrition that they follow is autotrophic mode of nutrition and heterotrophic mode of nutrition. Because they follow autotrophic mode of nutrition, they are called autotrophs, and they follow the other part follows the heterotrophic mode of nutrition, so they are called heterotrophs. Here I have written something in the bracket, that is autotrophs, they are also known as the producers. They are the producers. Producers means, and why do we call them as producers? Because they prepare their own food. They are the producers of their own food. They prepare their own food, that too from carbon dioxide, water and energy. That is, they take in the raw materials and they prepare their own. Very good examples of autotrophs are plants and algae. So autotrophs prepare their own food from carbon dioxide, water and energy. They are the producer, that is, they produce their own food. Now we move on to heterotrophs. Consumers means they consume, that is, they are not producers, they don't produce their own food. So autotrophs are the group of organisms that prepare their own food, and you can put producers, from carbon dioxide, water and energy. Example, plants and algae. And next is heterotrophs. What are heterotrophs? Heterotrophs are consumers, as they consume the produced food or the final food, or they are also known as the consumers or producers or consume the produced food. They are called the consumers. Examples, dogs, birds, humans. Now when we talk of the heterotrophs, we talk of the three modes of nutrition. Basically, heterotrophs again get divided into three types of heterotrophic mode of nutrition. They have been divided into three types based on the type of nutrition or based on the type of nutrition that they take. First is holozoic, then is saprophytic, and next comes parasitic. First is holozoic, then is saprophytic and parasitic. Now, what are holozoic, what are saprophytes, and what are parasites? Heterotrophs can be divided into three different groups. They all have the consume or the produced food, but in different ways, in different forms. So first we come to holozoic mode of nutrition under the heterotrophic mode of nutrition. So what is holozoic? The holozoics are those which are consumers which follow a particular way of digestion or the way of nutrition or taking in the food. So holozoic are a group of organisms which follow some particular way of taking their food. There the digestion happens inside the body after the food is ingested. So holozoic or organisms following holozoic mode of nutrition, they first take in the food, and after the food is ingested or it is taken in, then the process of digestion starts. So digestion happens inside the body. Digestion happens inside the body for holozoic mode of nutrition after the food is ingested. Only after the food is ingested. Only after the food is ingested, the digestion process starts. Now, when we are going through or we know about or we learn about holozoic mode of nutrition, there are different parts of holozoic mode of nutrition, or basically it can be divided, again divided into five different parts. First is ingestion, followed by digestion, absorption, assimilation and egestion. So first is ingestion. What is ingestion? Ingestion is nothing but the taking in of the food. What we told, the digestion happens in the body after the food is ingested, that is ingestion. First the food is taken, then the food is digested, that is the food or the complex food that we have, it is broken down into simple molecules so that the body can absorb that food that we are taking in. So first is ingestion, that is taking the food, then the food gets digested by getting broken into more simpler, more smaller molecules which the body can absorb, followed by absorption, that is the food that we have taken in, which gets broken down into smaller molecules, get absorbed by the body through the process of absorption. Then it is utilized. Utilized means it is transported to different parts of the body. That digested food, which is broken into smaller molecules, is utilized. And finally, the removal of the undigested food. And finally, what happens? The undigested food, which did not get digested through the whole process of digestion, gets removed out of the body in the form of egestion. So holozoic mode of nutrition, we have to remember that holozoic mode of nutrition occurs for those organisms whose digestion process starts only after the food is ingested. So that is very important for holozoic mode of nutrition. Digestion starts only after the food is ingested. The food is taken in and then the digestion starts. It does not happen before the food is being had, before the food has already been taken. Before that, the process doesn't start. And holozoic mode of nutrition can be divided into 5 parts, that is ingestion, digestion, absorption, assimilation and egestion. Next is saprophytic mode of nutrition. Saprophytic mode of nutrition, which we already know, that is organisms secrete. Here the organisms secrete some digestive juices. The organism immediately cannot take in the food or they cannot take in that produced food. So what they do, they secrete some digestive juices on this food. So what happens, the food starts getting digested. But remember, the organism or the organisms or the particular organisms which are following the saprophytic mode of nutrition, they have not taken in the food, they have not yet ingested the food, they have not yet taken the food, but since they have started secreting some digestive juices, which starts the process of digestion. So here the process of digestion starts before ingestion. Here the process of digestion starts only after the process of ingestion. So this is the basic difference between holozoic and saprophytic. Holozoic, the digestion process starts only after the food is taken in, only after ingestion is happened. Ingestion has happened. Here the food, the digestion starts first, the ingestion happens later. In holozoic, the ingestion happens first and then it is followed by digestion. So organism secretes some digestive juices on the food and the food is digested, which is still to be ingested. So this digested food is then ingested by the organism. After the food gets digested, that food is taken in by the organism. Example is housefly. So this is the saprophytic mode of nutrition. What is the basic difference between holozoic and saprophytic? Here in holozoic, first we take in the food, that is ingestion takes place, followed by digestion. In saprophyte, first the digestion takes place of the food by secretion of some juices and that digested food is taken in by the organism in the process of ingestion. So first digestion, then ingestion in saprophyte. In holozoic, it is first ingestion followed by digestion. And the last comes parasitic. What is parasitic? The parasitic are the organisms which live inside or outside another organism. That is, it is living inside or outside another organism which it treats as host and derives nutrition from it. It derives the nutrition, directly derives the nutrition from that host. It doesn't follow anything. It doesn't take in, means the prepared food in which form it can absorb. It stays with the host. It takes it from the host directly without going through any process of digestion. It is directly ingest and that too the exact prepared food that it wants, it takes in. Example, you can call us Cuscuta and take. And for holozoic, the best example is the humans, animals, birds, etc. So we can again recall that nutrition can be divided into 2 parts, that is heterotrophic mode of nutrition and autotrophic mode of nutrition. Autotrophic mode of nutrition, they are the producers of their own food from carbon dioxide, water and energy. They are basically the plants. And heterotrophic mode of nutrition is followed by the heterotrophs, which are consumers. They cannot prepare their own food. They have to have the prepared food. Now, heterotrophic mode of nutrition can be again divided. Among the heterotrophs, it is again divided based on the way of their taking in that in nutrition. We can divide it again on holozoic, saprophytic and parasitic. In holozoic, digestion happens after ingestion of the food in the process of digestion, followed by absorption, assimilation and excretion. Then comes saprophytic, in which the organism secretes some digestive juices onto the food. The food gets digested and then the organism ingests the food, takes in the food. So in saprophytic mode of nutrition, first it is basically the digestion followed by ingestion, And last we come to parasitic, where the organism or the parasite lives on inside or outside another organism, which it considers is as its host. And it takes the nutrition directly from the host. It does not follow any of the processes. It directly takes the nutrition in which forms it want. It takes it from the host. Example, Cuscuta and tick. For saprophytic, your example can be housefly. And for holozoic, your example can be humans, birds, animals, etc. Then we move on to autotrophic mode of nutrition. What we decided or what we have learned about autotrophic mode of nutrition, that it is autotrophic nutrition. It is a process in which the organisms produce their own food from simple organic constituents, such as water, carbon dioxide, minerals in the process and or in the presence of sunlight. So it is the organism which produce their own food. Organisms produce their own food and from simple organic constituents such as water, carbon dioxide and minerals in the presence of sunlight. So, autotrophic mode of nutrition, what is the definition if it is asked? It is a process in which the organisms prepare their own food from simple inorganic constituents. It is from simple inorganic constituents such as water, carbon dioxide and minerals in the presence of sunlight. So this is basically autotrophic mode of nutrition is the most primary mode of nutrition for the plants of preparing food. That is, I think all of us know, it is known as photosynthesis. Photosynthesis is something which is very common term, which is dealt everywhere regarding plant nutrition, plants, how do they prepare food. The first thing we come to know or we get to know is photosynthesis. So what is photosynthesis? If we are asked what is photosynthesis, what is the definition that we are going to give? It is a process by which carbon dioxide and water is converted into carbohydrates. It is the sugar that is prepared by the plants for obtaining energy, for obtaining nutrition, for their other life processes. Carbohydrates, energy rich compound in the presence of sunlight and chlorophyll. So what is the equation that we define or we give it for photosynthesis is 6CO2, that is 6 molecules of carbon dioxide plus 12 molecules of water in the presence of sunlight, and with the help of chlorophyll it is converted into 2 molecules of glucose, that is C6H12O6 plus 6 molecules of oxygen is liberated. So basically, for the process of photosynthesis, what is it? It is the process by which carbon dioxide and water is converted into carbohydrate, which is an energy-rich compound in the presence of sunlight and chlorophyll. And given by this equation of 6CO2 plus 12H2O gives 2 molecules of C6H12O6 plus 6 molecules of oxygen or 6O2. The following events that occurs during the process of photosynthesis. So first, what happens? The chlorophyll absorbs the energy. Sunlight is able to get absorbed by the plants because of this pigment called chlorophyll, which also imparts the green color to the leaves. Light energy converted to chemical energy by chlorophyll. So the light energy that is absorbed from the sun is converted into chemical energy. Second point is that light energy converted to chemical energy by dissociation of water into hydrogen and oxygen. So how this light energy gets converted into chemical energy? By dissociation of water. So this water molecule that is taken in during this process of photosynthesis, or 12 water molecules, it gets dissociated into hydrogen and oxygen. How finally the carbon dioxide is absorbed and is reduced into carbohydrates. Carbohydrates, why it is called reduced? Because addition of hydrogen is taking place over here. So the carbon dioxide absorbed is reduced to carbohydrates. So what are the events that is happening during the process of photosynthesis? First is the chlorophyll. The chlorophyll in the leaves absorbs this light energy, and this light energy is converted into chemical energy. This light energy, this conversion of this light energy to chemical energy happens or is taken place by the dissociation of water molecules that is absorbed by the roots of the plants. The dissociation of the water molecules, what it gives? The water dissociates to give hydrogen and oxygen. And finally, the carbon dioxide that is also absorbed during the process of photosynthesis is reduced to form carbohydrates. It shows what is happening in the process of photosynthesis. This is a plant. It is taking in the light energy. It is taking in the light energy. Along with it, carbon dioxide is also be taken in along with water. And this green leaves has the chlorophyll, which converts the light energy into chemical energy and also helps in dissociation of this water into hydrogen and oxygen. And finally, carbohydrates is produced in the leaves. Carbohydrates gets produced and in turn oxygen is liberated. So this is an overall view of the process of autotrophic mode of nutrition. Studying for photosynthesis, four things are very important. That is the raw materials or the raw materials that is required, that is carbon dioxide and water, is converted into carbohydrates, that is energy rich compounds, in the presence of sunlight and chlorophyll. So we give in the equation of 6CO2 plus 12H2O. In presence of chlorophyll and sunlight, we get 2C6H12O6 plus 6O2. This is already I have told you, this is 6 carbon dioxide, 6 molecules of carbon dioxide, but 12 molecules of water gives 2 molecules of glucose and 6 molecules of oxygen. This oxygen is liberated and is given out again into the atmosphere. So what are the following, the events that occurs during photosynthesis? So just to have a brief description or brief knowledge about what is happening during photosynthesis. The first thing that is happening, that is the chlorophyll is absorbs light energy. Light energy is converted into chemical energy by chlorophyll. So the light energy, the chlorophyll absorbs the light energy. The light energy is obtained from the sun and this is converted into chemical energy. Now this light energy is converted into chemical energy by dissociation of water. The conversion of light energy, that is the sun's energy, into chemical energy for performing of this reaction or performing of this process of photosynthesis, it is converted to chemical energy. So chemical energy is formed out of light energy by the dissociation of water. The energy is obtained by the dissociation of water into hydrogen and oxygen. The carbon dioxide absorbed is reduced to carbohydrates. The carbon dioxide that is absorbed from the atmosphere by the leaves, that is reduced to form carbohydrates. The carbohydrates generated in the plants in the form of during the process of photosynthesis, it generally what provides energy to the plant. Its excess is stored in the form of excess amount that is generated or that is produced, the carbohydrate or the sugar that is produced by the plant during photosynthesis, it is stored in the form of starch. The CO2 received from the plants through gaseous exchange through the tiny pores present on the surface of the leaves are called stomata. Now we were talking about the carbon dioxide as a raw material for photosynthesis. So many will be thinking that how do that carbon dioxide gets into the plant? How do the carbon dioxide, because water is taken up by the roots, the light energy is absorbed by the chlorophyll, or chlorophyll is that pigment present in the leaf or in present in the plants that absorbs the light energy. Now how that gas, that carbon dioxide, it moves into the plant? It moves into the plant through a So through the leaf surface or through which on the leaf surface there is some tiny pores present on the leaf surface of the plant, and this is called the stomata. So the carbon dioxide that is taken up or that is utilized during photosynthesis is taken up through the tiny pores that is present on the leaves of the plant, and they are called stomata. Water along with nitrogen, phosphorus, iron, magnesium is all taken up by the roots during the absorption of water or during the absorption of water. So what we can tell that water along with nitrogen, phosphorus, iron, magnesium is taken up by the roots. Is taken up by the roots along with the water. This water is utilized during the process of photosynthesis. So in a quick way, what we can remember, photosynthesis, the main ingredients or the raw materials required is carbon dioxide and water. This is converted into a carbohydrate, which is an energy rich organic compound, which is converted to carbohydrate, energy rich compound in the presence of sunlight and chlorophyll. This is an equation of the photosynthesis, and this is an important equation which we must remember, because anywhere they are asking of photosynthesis, this equation gives an added marks, and this equation is very important wherever you are writing the definition of photosynthesis or you're explaining photosynthesis or talking anything about photosynthesis, because this gives a total idea of what is happening in photosynthesis. These are the following events that are happening. So this is all about photosynthesis that we are going to know. I will tell you a little bit more about the stomata and how does the stomata work and how does the stomata take in the carbon dioxide. Okay. So now we are going to understand a little bit about stomata, of the stomata and the guard cells. So this is a typical structure of a stomata. This is a closed stomata and this is a open stomata. That is how you generally see. The stomata are very minute pores. They are not visible through the naked eye. If we are able to take a thin peel of leaf and we observe under a microscope, these structures are to be seen. They are very minute in nature. They are very minute. They are microscopic structures, as I told you. You need to observe it under a microscope. Now, this is a stomata. This is a stomata, and how does the stomata function? Basically, how does the carbon dioxide get into the plant through the opening of stomata, through the stomatal opening during the process of photosynthesis? So this is what happens. When the plants need to take in carbon dioxide, the stomata needs to get open, then only it can enter, the carbon dioxide can enter. So what happens? Water rushes into these guard cells. This guard cell happens almonds whenever they become swollen, they become intubular in structure. They extend out, they pull out, they move out towards, and as they move out, they create a space in between, they create a round space, and this is the opening that they provide. This opening helps for the carbon dioxide to enter. So water rushes into the guard cell during osmosis, so increasing the cell turgency as well as the size and exposing the pores. This pore, once it gets exposed, it can happen the gaseous exchange, any of the gaseous exchange can. And again, when the stomata needs to close down, that the stomata needs to come to this section, that is already gaseous exchange has been done, everything is over. And there is the inflow of potassium ions into the guard cells. Due to the potassium ions, there is fall in the water potential. So immediately water starts rushing out of the guard cell. As the water starts rushing out, the cells become flaccid. The cell becomes very flat. They do lose their tubular structure. They become flat, and slowly the opening that was created, this goes off and the stomata closes. To have a quick recap, what is stomata? Stomata are the tiny pores present on the leaf surface which helps in for the exchange of gases, or which helps it to take up carbon dioxide during the process of photosynthesis. What are the functions of stomata? There are two main functions of stomata. That is, it allows for gaseous exchange as an entry of carbon dioxide as well as an release or exit of oxygen. It allows the gaseous exchange, that is entry of carbon dioxide, which is required for photosynthesis, and release of oxygen, which is released as a byproduct during photosynthesis. And second is regulating water movement through transpiration. These things have to be kept in mind. These are very minute things, but very small things at very important. The functions of stomata, how is the stomata opening and closing, as well as the structure of a stomata. So we have had an idea about the autotrophic mode of other part, where we had divided nutrition into two types, that is autotrophs and heterotrophs. We had divided into autotrophs and heterotrophs. So first, autotroph, that is the plants which produce their own food, they are their own producers. And next is the heterotrophic mode of nutrition, or heterotrophic nutrition. It is the mode of nutrition in which the organisms depend upon other organisms for their food to survive. They can't make their own food like the autotroph. And under heterotrophic mode of nutrition, we had discussed, if you remember, that there are three types of nutrition types which are available. That is, or they can be classified, the heterotrophs can be classified into three types based on the type of the nutrition. That is holozoic mode of nutrition, saprophytic mode of nutrition, and finally the parasitic mode of nutrition. In holozoic mode of nutrition, first step is ingestion followed by digestion, whereas in saprophytes it is first digestion followed by ingestion, whereas in parasites it totally depends on the host. That is, the host is a living, it either stays on the host or it integrates itself within the host and it obtains the nutrition from the host. This is the basic difference between holozoic, saprophytic and parasitic mode of nutrition, or organisms following this mode of nutrition. So first we are going to deal with the holozoic mode of nutrition. So supposedly this is an amoeba. It recognizes a food particle. It recognizes a food particle. So immediately the amoeba, what it does is provides, or it tries, or it prepares to finger-like projections. It prepares to finger-like projections to just encapsulate or to gather the food or to take a hold of the food. And this is called the pseudopodia. Slowly this engulfs the food. This is the food particle. This is the food particle, and slowly it engulfs it. Slowly it takes in. Here what it happens, slowly it starts giving out some digestive juices for digestion, or digesting that food particle which you have just now engulfed. So this is the process of digestion. The first step and second was the process of ingestion, where it recognizes the food particle and then it produces some finger-like projections to obtain or to just engulf the food. Third is the food vacuole. It actually engulfs the food particle totally and slowly starts secreting some digestive juices so as to digest the food particle. Now this food particle gets digested slowly through the process of digestion, and then it starts the process of absorption. The amoeba starts absorbing that food particle or the nutrients obtained from that food particle. Then it starts assimilating. Assimilating means it starts distributing the nutrition obtained from that food particle throughout the body, or throughout the amoeba, because throughout the amoeba it requires the nutrition to live. And finally, whatever food particles which was not digested or which was not required by the amoeba is given out through the process of ejection. So this is a simple mode of holozoic. This is a simple holozoic mode of nutrition that is being followed by the process of amoeba. Even we humans also follow the same holozoic mode of nutrition. That is, all the processes also go, but we have a complex nature with many acids and many other chemical reactions happening inside the body, so that I'll come to up here later. So now we will discuss, or we will learn about the holozoic mode of nutrition that we human beings follow. So here what happens, this is a digestive system of the human beings, that is of our human beings. This is the digestive system. Here is the salivary glands on the top of the mouth. This is the tongue. This is the epiglottis, the esophagus, the stomach. This is the pharynx, pancreas, liver. This is gallbladder, large intestine, small intestine, rectum, anus and appendix. So now we will explain us now. Now I will explain how exactly does the digestion takes place. Our digestion is not at all as simple as we have studied in amoeba. It is quite a complex process of digestion that takes place, involving many acids, many different steps where the food passes through, and finally it gets digested, and the undigested food is also given out through the process of egestion. So when we start with, it is the mouth. In the mouth, that is, we take in the food, or we eat the food in the mouth, and there first digestion process starts. First, what we do, immediately when we have our food or when we take in our food, the teeth starts chewing of the food. We start chewing of the food with the help of our teeth. That is, either we grind the food or we chew the food to make it into smaller pieces, because that is a big pieces that we are having. That pieces needs to be broken down into still smaller pieces. So basic of chewing, the tongue helps in rolling of the food, the passing of the food or tasting of the food. That is the two functions of teeth and tongue that happens in the mouth. Immediately the salivary glands, which is present here, starts secreting a thing called saliva. This saliva helps in the digestion of the food, helps in the digestion of the food. So what it does, this saliva has a particular enzyme called salivary amylase. This salivary amylase helps in making or converting or changing the starch. That is, the food that we are having is starch. It helps in converting the starch into sugar. Be careful when you are studying for the digestive enzyme, because here many parts of the human digestive system is involved, and it secretes different things at different point of time, and each has its own function. Starting from the salivary glands, the teeth, the tongue, the esophagus, forming to the stomach, inside the stomach there is secretion of the three juices, that is pepsin, HCl and mucus. Each have their own function. Then it moves into the small intestine. The small intestine again gets the secretion of the liver, it secretes the bile juice, and pancreas, it secretes the pancreatic juices. So what happens in the small intestine? The intestinal enzymes helps into for the further breaking down of the carbohydrates to glucose, the fats to fatty acid and glycerol, and protein to amino acid. The pancreatic juice helps in the secretion of trypsin, which increase or which further decomposes protein into peptones. Lipase, it from the emulsified fats, that is fatty acid and glycerol. Lipase, it helps in the breaking down of the emulsified fats into fatty acid and glycerol. This is what I have told you here, that is protein to amino acid, it is done by trypsin, and fats to fatty acid and glycerol is done by lipase. The protein that here which functions in the intestinal enzyme for the small intestine, that is the protein happens for the secretion of trypsin, which helps to break down the protein into amino acid, and fats are broken down to fatty acid and glycerol with the help of the enzyme lipase. Then, so what happens after the food is digested in the small intestine, then automatically from the small intestine, the digested food, this food that is broken down into smallest particles or simpler particles, the complex food which has been broken down or it has been digested, this food is taken up or absorbed by the blood from the small intestine. The undigested food which did not get digested or which was not required by the body moves to the large intestine. From large intestine, what happens into the large intestine? The water, the excess water that is there in the undigested food is taken out or it is removed. It removes the absorbs the excess of water, the large intestine, and that is formed the only the undigested food is left behind, and it slowly it moves out and it comes to the rectum and anus, and then it is given out through the process of ejection. So basically here we have discussed all about, that is, we have discussed about how the food is ingested, how the food is digested, then followed by it how it is absorbed, assimilated, and then finally it is ejected. Ejection takes place. Then the assimilation, what we have told, and for absorption we have told that from the small intestine the digested food is taken off from the blood, but we have not talked about assimilation, that is transporting to different parts of the body. That we'll again talk in the later parts of the chapter when we will discuss about transportation, that is the food, how it is taken to different parts of the body, it is carried on to the different parts of the body, and there we will talk about it in detail. So this holozoic mode of nutrition that is followed by human beings, it is a bit complex and has a number of enzymes and number of organs involved. So be very careful or be very attentive when you're reading it. Try to keep the things in mind. If once you get to understand it properly, it becomes very easy and very simple. Just you have to remember the names of the acid that is being, or the enzyme that has been secreted, and what is the function of that particular enzyme, from where is it been secreted, particularly in which part, it is in the stomach or it is in the small intestine or it is in the mouth, that you have to be very careful of. So here we have discussed about the first part. We have completed the first part, that is mostly the nutrition part of our chapter, life processes. So what we have discussed in the first part of nutrition, we have first discussed about life processes and first told that the first most important thing for a life to continue is nutrition. So we have discussed about what are the two types of nutrition: autotrophic nutrition and heterotrophic mode of nutrition. The organisms which follow the autotrophic mode of nutrition are called autotrophs, examples are plants, and the organisms which follow the heterotrophic mode of nutrition is like animals, birds, and human beings, etc., which they follow the heterotrophic mode of nutrition, that is they cannot prepare their own food, they have to depend on others for the food or for the prepared food that they have. Under autotrophic mode of nutrition, we have talked about the plant, how they took on the process of photosynthesis. We have discussed about the equation of photosynthesis. We have discussed about what are the changes or what is happening during the process of photosynthesis inside the plant. And we have also talked about the small pores that are present on the leaves, that is the stomata, the opening of the stomata, the closing of the stomata, that we have all dealt about. Then when we moved on to the heterotrophic mode of nutrition, we have told the heterotrophic mode of nutrition is followed by organisms, but there are three different type of mode of nutrition, that is under heterotroph there are again three mode of different types of nutrition. First we have talked about holozoic mode of nutrition, then saprophytic mode of nutrition, and finally the parasitic mode of nutrition. In holozoic mode of nutrition, we have told that the food digestion of the food takes place in five steps, that is it involves first is ingestion, followed by the digestion, then is absorption, assimilation, and finally ejection. And when we have talked about the holozoic mode of nutrition, we have discussed about how a digestion or how the food is being taken by an amoeba, which is a single cellular and organism, and it follows a very easy and simple way of holozoic mode of nutrition. We have also discussed a complex mode of holozoic mode of nutrition which happens in humans. It involves many organs, it involves many parts of the body, and it is a long process that takes place involving and secretion of many enzyme, secretion of many acids, and different types of food, different enzymes are secreted for this digestion, and how the whole process of holozoic mode of nutrition is followed in human beings also. So students, if you have any doubt, you can surely put in my comment section whatever doubts you have. I'll surely come back and clear the doubts. If you have any questions, you can ask me. In my next video, I will come up with the process of respiration. I will talk about respiration, the differences between respiration and nutrition, and what's happening. I will be discussing. So if you like my video, please share, like, and subscribe to my channel. Thank you.